to you philosophically about all we need is love, which I know that sounds fluffy, but I don't know of any university in America who teaches a philosophical approach to music education, right? There's like philosophy of education, but not, I don't know of a single school that offers philosophy of music education. We don't at Drury, and we probably never will. But I think it's an important thing to think about how and why we do what we do, because I think we could all agree anybody can teach a quarter note, right? La, 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 echo me back. And then the class goes, la, la, we got it. Anybody can teach that, but what makes the difference is how that quarter note is taught, and how that quarter note is taught can move someone to want to sing it or play it. And that's where philosophy comes into play, because anybody can get up and teach the basics, but how it's taught moves a child to want to sing or play that note. And that's really, in essence, what I want to talk to you about. So we're going to talk philosophically about love and music education. And I have a quote there by Parker J. Palmer from In the Courage to Teach. He says it best, we teach who we are. Teaching, like any truly human activity, emerges from one's inwardness, for better or worse. As I teach, I project the condition of my soul onto my students, my subject, and our way of being together. The entanglements I experience in the classroom are often no more or less than the convolutions of my inner life. Viewed from this angle, teaching holds a mirror to the soul. If I'm willing to look in that mirror and not run from what I see, I have a chance to gain self-knowledge, and knowing myself is as crucial to good teaching as knowing my students and my subject. So imagine a teacher in front of the classroom, in front of the ensemble, who's done the work, they've looked in the mirror, they see, wow, that's who I am. I've seen all my faults, and I've taken them to the Lord, and I've dealt with them, and come to the podium or come to the lecture stand being whole and centered. And think about the effect that that person has on a classroom. Or you have a person take the podium on the opposite end who's an egomaniac and trying to see what they can get out of their students for their own personal fulfillment, either emotionally or spiritually or in the profession. I'll get something out of you. You'll sing great so that my choir or band is invited to this convention, right? Or I want to see you, and I want to see what we can develop in you and what your gifts are, and how can I bring you along in a real holistic way? So I want to encourage all of you to know thyself. To know thyself. It's the best thing you could ever do, and then bring a holistic, centered person to the podium. I think you want to be cautious to take care of your soul, and I want to encourage you to think about your soul like an infant, right? So being careful what you think about, what you listen to, what you read, what you take in, if you're sitting in the seat of the scornful, or if you're sitting in the seat of the cheerleaders, what are you doing with your soul? And when you think about a little infant and how you take care of an infant, and what you would feed them, and how you would take care of them if it was cold or rainy, and the special care, that's the care that you need to take for yourself. So that as you're projecting the condition of your soul onto your students, they're going, oh, thank you. I was so thirsty. I didn't even know I was thirsty. And now you're my teacher and I'm drinking from you, right? Or they're looking at you and thinking, oh my goodness, you're killing me. I used to love music. I used to love being alive. And now I'm wondering, why am I alive? And why am I stuck in this room with you every single day? And you're hurting me. You know what I'm saying? So take care of your soul like a little infant, so that when you come to the classroom, you have wholeness and love and joy to bring you. Our philosophical goal, again by Parker J. Palmer, I'm a teacher at heart. And there are moments in the classroom when I can hardly hold the joy, when my students and I discover uncharted territory to explore, when the pathway out of a thicket opens up before us, when our experience is illumined by the lightning life of the mind, then teaching is the finest work I know. And I added a whoop of joy. You may have been in a rehearsal or a classroom one time when the teacher made you feel so alive, or the ensemble was really getting after the music in a really passionate, this is how it should sound every time kind of way, and you just feel your soul and your heart bubbling up so much that you just have to go, woo, yes, yes. I was born for this moment. I was born for this moment. Yes, thank you very much. And when that happens in the classroom, I want to encourage all of you to let your students see that, right? It is tough when you first start teaching to be vulnerable, to put yourself out there, to show how you're being moved, especially on the opposite ends of the spectrum, either in a positive way or in a negative way. But students can sniff out a fake. The first second you take that podium and you start speaking, they're like, I think you're lying to me. I don't think this is the real deal. I don't think this is you at all. But when you gain enough courage and confidence to show up, open the shutters of your heart and say, this is how I think, this is how I feel, this is what we're going to explore about this music, I'm here with you, I'm in the trenches with you, then they will latch on to you hand in hand. Everything comes alive. Our goal is to increase the numbers of these experiences every year, every month, every day. Why are we here? This is a question I have asked myself a lot in life. I've stopped asking because I am in my 50s now, which feels on most days okay. But I think I figured out why we're here. And the simple answer, have you guys read Francis Chan's Crazy Love? Have you read, anybody read that? Yeah, you should be reading it. The first time I started reading it, one of my high school students gave me the book and he said, Mr. Lally, I think you should read this book. I read a few pages and I was so convicted, I put it down. And he goes, Mr. Lally, what did you think about Crazy Love? And I said, well, I'm not reading it. And he said, why? And I said, I was so convicted, I couldn't be looking in that mirror. And I had to put it down. I did eventually read it, but on page 97, I have no idea what page number. On one of the pages, Francis Chan poses that question. Why are we here? What is our purpose? To teach music, right? To be a scientist? We're here to love. We're here to love. That is our one. That's why God put you on this earth. In your career, in your path, in your classroom, with your ensemble, with your suite mate, wherever you are, to love. That is the one reason that we're here. And when you think of, when you take a step back and you think about love, it is the one thing that we all have in common. It's the one thing that we all need. We need to be loved. We want to be loved. We want to be valued. We want to be respected. And you'll have a classroom full of students of varying needs. You know, when we think about differentiating education for special needs and for really bright and talented, but another way to think about it is you'll have students who come in who are completely whole, they have beautiful parents, but the greater number of parents are from broken homes or they have parents who are emotionally sick and they need someone to show up in their class and say, you know what? I love you, but I love you enough to say you cannot be doing that because you're getting in our way of learning this song. And then they're going to think because of their parents, now when you show up tomorrow, you're hating me. You hate me, Mr. Lally. She's going to be thinking, you hate me, Mr. Lally. You got on to me. And then because you know thyself and you've taken all of your faults before the throne, you show up the next day and say, hey, it is so good to see you. And I know today is going to be a better day than yesterday, right? And they will say, right, and away you go. And they're like, oh my goodness, this person can discipline me and still stay in the trenches and believe in me and care for me and invest in me. And it's not over just because I messed up one time. Where at home, you messed up. And you know, I don't have to go through all the horrible scenarios that you read in the newspaper or you hear on the news about sick parents who discipline their children in a way that's not holistic. And you're going to have those kids. And that's why you're there. To be standing there shining, as the quote that Sharon read says, to be standing there shining and to be an example of, I will discipline you because I love you. You are capable of more than that, and I'll require that you bring your very best. And the next day when you have let me down, I'll be there so we can just start anew. Just like God's mercy is new for us every single morning, your mercy must be new for your students every single morning. But before you can offer that mercy new, fresh every morning for your students, you have to be offering it for yourself. And that might be something you've never thought about before. Like, God's mercy is new every morning, but is mine? Can I forgive myself after God has forgiven me? Or do I want to keep lugging around that pain of disappointment and I could have done better, but I didn't? Or can I receive his complete mercy and let that go and launch in today determined to do better than I did the day before? Something to think about. Paul says, if we have all faith so as to move mountains, but have not love, I am nothing. If I give away all I have, if I deliver up my body to be burned, but have not love, I gain nothing. All we need is love. Here's a couple stories of love. When I was teaching high school, the first class I always gave my student teachers was the class that I enjoyed teaching the least. Now, I don't know if that was wise, but it's honest. How about that? So I think, and I tell them, like, just so you know, as you're observing this first day of student teaching, the first class you will have a seventh hour. So when you observe that today, just start percolating ideas, because that's the first thing you're going to have, right? And it's the hardest one to teach. Last hour of the day, right? And for me, the seventh hour choir was Y'all Come Choir. It was non-performing choir, and most students took it because they wanted a fine arts credit. And I remember one year when I had about 64 or so enrolled in there, I said, raise your hand if you love to sing. And like five hands went up out of 64. I said, raise them again. So they raised their hand. I said, everyone look around and see how many hands are raised. Do you see that? I said, does that look surprising to you that five people like to sing, but the rest of you don't, and you're in a choir class where we're gonna be singing every day? Let's just think about that for a moment. Right? Yeah, so that's the first class that I give to student teachers. Because it was so challenging. So I had a student teacher from MSU one year, and actually MSU called me and they said, Mark, would you take a student teacher? I said, no, absolutely not. I'm tired of student teachers. I just want them to be mine and me to be theirs. And it's very selfish, very selfish. And I said, no, I will not. I said, wait, who is it? So they told me who it was, and it was a student from MSU who had done a practicum with us, and we fell in love with her. She only came 10 hours. And on her 10th hour, my accompanist, Candy French, and I both bought her presents. 10 hours, and we bought her a present. She came in doing a practicum, and so here I am, and here's the piano, and here's the choir, and usually a practicum student will just come in and observe, and they'll kind of cower by the office, or they'll hide behind the ensemble, or somewhere, you know, like, oh my gosh, people are looking at me and taking a few notes. No, so here's me, here's the piano, here's the ensemble, and her name is Rachel Buboltz, and she pulled up a chair and sat right here. So she's facing the ensemble, so she's sitting here with her hands in her lap, sitting up straight and tall. She's looking at the choir. She'll look at me, look at the choir, look at me, look at the choir, look at me, and just soaking it all in. She was perfectly comfortable just sitting right there. She'd take a few notes, and then she'd leave. And we just fell in love with her. So when MSU called and said, would you take Rachel Buboltz? I said, yes, I will. So she got seventh hour. I warned her, and she got seventh hour. And I was in my office, and it was very quiet in seventh hour. And so my radar went up, and I thought, what is happening in seventh hour? And it's quiet. Did she take them out the door? And I missed out on this now. So I went and stood next to her. She was in front of the class teaching, and I folded my arms like this. I said, what is happening? And she said, I don't know what you mean. I said, everyone is working, and it's very quiet in here. What is going on? And this is what she said. This is the truth. I love them. Well, I didn't like that at all. You know, it just heaped coals of guilt on me. She said, I love them. And I looked at them, challenging students. You know, when you teach middle school and high school, you'll see students have, it starts sometimes in fifth and sixth grade, but students get something called the disease. Yeah, it's not in a textbook, but I call it the disease. And so you'll see like, oh, you've got the disease. And what the disease is, I don't like myself. I don't like you. I don't like this class. I don't like her. I don't like him. I don't like that I'm alive. I got the disease. And as soon as you can give that diagnosis, like, boom, disease, you'll be a great teacher to that student, because you'll realize, okay, it's not me. You're not hating me. It's not really the class. It's just you hate everything. And so I'm gonna like water you and fertilize you and love on you as much as you'll let me, but I realize you'll have the disease, and they will come out of it. And you know, for some students, high school is a prison. It's the worst place for them. That's just the truth. And their finest day is when they get out of that prison and they have a job and they're doing what they love to do. So that's something to think about too. So Mrs. Buboltz said, I love them. The students knew that she loved them, and they worked so hard for her. Do you know what she did with that class? Do you know what she had the disgusting nerve to do? Is she taught them a unit on opera. I was like, this is never gonna fly. They don't care about opera, blah, 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 blah. So what she did was, I don't remember what the opera was. She posted pictures of opera singers in the room, the leads in the role. So she would play a little snippet of an aria from the opera, and then she'd tell the class, go stand by who just sang that. and they go stand over here. And so they talked about voice types. And then, you know, you can't not take a group of unmotivated people and say, we're going to watch a 3-hour opera. Buckle up. Oh, good. Let's watch it. It's not going to happen. So what she did was she printed out part of the libretto, and like, you would be Don Juan, right? And you would be so-and-so, and she'd have the students come up, and they'd read a scene from the opera, right? And they'd act it out, and then they'd watch that little scene from the opera. And they were loving it. And they were eating out of the palm of her hand. And when her supervisor from MSU came to observe her, and we talked privately, he said, I can't believe she taught them a unit on opera. These students are the last one who should be having a unit on opera, blah, 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 blah. And I was getting disgusted as he was talking to me. And I said, just a minute. And I shut my office door. I said, you are making me very angry right now, because what you have on your hands is a master teacher as a student teacher. And if there were an award for student teacher of the year, she should get it. Who's going to teach these kids about opera if she doesn't? And she has taught them, and they have invested in it, and they have loved it, and they have learned things they would never learn. And you're criticizing someone for bringing brilliance and inspiration and engagement? What's wrong with you? I didn't say what's wrong with you. I just was setting the record straight, and I ended it with, again, like, if there's an award for Student Teacher of the Year, she should get it. And do you know what he did? So I'm feeling very good, because I've helped him along to understand. When he met with her, he told her the same thing. You should have never taught a unit on opera to those students. What in the world? What's wrong with you? And it's a very nice man, a very nice man, but he got it wrong with her. One of the girls in the class, her name was Kat. That's what she wanted to be called. That was not actually her name. She was unusual. And after the student teacher left, she had to go into Lakeland, which is a hospital here in Springfield for mental illness. And on Rachel's last day of student teaching, she brought all the students in seventh hour. She had written them all a note. And she'd stayed up into the wee hours of the morning. And she also brought one of those 5-hour energy drinks that you can get from like Get and Go. Yeah, and Quick Stop, and I hid it from her. I said, what is this? And she said, I won't have enough energy for today. I said, this is bad, I love you, and these will be hidden. And I hid them from her. I actually threw them away, she never got them. That's bad stuff, don't be doing that to yourself. So when Kat came back from being in Lakeland, she came to seventh hour. Now they have Mr. Lolly, who's trying very hard to love them the best way I can. And Kat comes in and she's holding this note. And she goes, guess what I got? I said, I don't know. She said, when Mrs. Buboltz left, she left a note for me with the counselors. And the counselors called me in today and gave me this note from Mrs. Buboltz. I love this class. It's my favorite class I've ever had. Because of Mr. Lolly? No. Because of Mrs. Buboltz, who loved them and just invested in them and cared for them. And they knew it. Right? One more story about love. I was playing for Shelby Baker. And Sharon, I think you were Melissa Baker. I don't know her maiden name. I think you were her high school teacher. And she was auditioning for all district choir, and I was playing for her. And she was singing like she had never sung before. And she had this ethereal, angelic look on her face. I could barely play the piano because I was staring at her. I'm like, what is going on? How is she singing so well? She's transported somewhere. There's no angst. There's no striving. There's no jitters. She's just singing so beautifully. We got out in the hall and I said, what happened in there? She goes, what do you mean? I said, I've never heard you sing like that. And I've never seen you look like that. What was that? She said, I was just doing what the student teacher, oh, you student teachers. She said, I was just doing what the student teacher told me to do. And I said, what did the student teacher tell you to do? She said, the student teacher told me that it wasn't about striving. It wasn't about competing. It wasn't about beating someone out. It wasn't about showing off. It was about this. This is what I have to offer. This is what I have to offer. She said, so when I sang, I didn't think about my score. I didn't think about making the top 25 in the district, which she did. I didn't think about making Allstate, which she did not. I didn't think about that. I thought about, this is what I have to offer. And she said, I just offered what I had. And it spoke in genuine authenticity and beauty in her sound. Talk about love. When I went to interview at Drury, this is what I thought. This is what I have to offer. Right, I didn't go to get the job because of the student teacher, because of Shelby Baker. This is what I have to offer. The dean said to me, what do you know about Drury? And I said, nothing. That's the truth. I said, nothing. And he goes, okay, well, if there's something that we could change, and I realized that was a very poor answer, but I didn't go to get the job. I went to, this is what I have to offer. And if I'm the man, I'm the man. If I'm not the man, I'm not the man. And you don't want me to be here, and I don't want to be here. And he said, well, what could we do better at Drury? I said, well, here's the deal. I went to high school in this area, and I've been teaching here for a long time. I don't know anything about Drury. That's a problem. So that's something you could fix. You need to figure out how to get into the schools and how to get into the media and let people like me, who've been here forever, know something about Drury, because I don't know one thing. So my bad answer turned into a good one. Turned into a good one. But I just went to that interview. This is what I have to offer. And here's the deal. When you interview for a job, you don't want to be at that school if you're not the right one, right? You don't want to be with those people if you're not the right one. If you're not the right fit, you don't want to be there. Take the rejection. Think, oh, God, thank you. You have something for me to do somewhere else significantly. I met with a student today, and she said, well, should I be at a small school or a large school? I said, you should be where God wants you to be. That's where he's going to use you. And she's a beautiful Aubrey Smith, Alberta's daughter. She will be beautiful anywhere she goes. Why? Because she speaks from a point of stillness. She knows herself. And I said, if you're at a small school, those kids will drink you up. They will think about music and singing in a way that would never be possible without you being there. And if you're at a big school, you'll just take it, you know, you'll just take the bull by the horns and you'll charge on to success. It doesn't matter. And for all of you, especially here at Evangel, it doesn't matter where you'll be. You'll be exactly where God wants you to be. And by the time it's time, you'll be ready. When I was teaching high school, I was part of the interview teams. For when coaches would come, the superintendent said, Mark, I want you on the coaches' interview teams because I want all the coaches to know that they're on our team, right? And sometimes coaches and music directors can get things messed around, like, you know, I'm in charge, this is about me, this is my program, and athletic coaches could do that too. We had a football coach interview at Willard, and Willard's having an amazing football season this year, and the football coach, his last name is Roten, he's an Evangel alum. And at his interview, I asked him this question. I said, I know you're an Evangel alum, so I feel comfortable asking you this. I said, Evangel teaches us all truth is God's truth, no matter where it's found. What is the truth in football? And he said, oh my word, I have a very short list of really challenging questions that I've been asked in an interview, but this one's going on the list. I said, well, I hope you have an answer, because I hope you're not wasting time or our students' time playing football if there's no truth in it. What is the truth in football? And I have to be honest and say, I don't know what he said, but it was an excellent answer. He pulled something out of his hat. But we have to be thinking about that. Like, why are we doing what we're doing? We're here to love. That's why God will put you with that student at that school for that conversation with the cook, for that conversation with the janitor, for that girl who has no self-esteem whatsoever, and you'll be the one that invests in her and help her to see honestly things that she didn't even know, qualities that she didn't even know she had, and you'll point them out. And when she messes up, you'll say, you messed up, and you can do better. And because I love you, I'm gonna expect you to do better tomorrow. And not just that you'll do better, here's how you can do it. You're gonna do this, and this, and this, and this, and then you will become, because you can. Yeah, okay, the naysayers. Here's why people don't like to think about love. They're uncomfortable. They're uncomfortable thinking about loving students. And you know, in our social climate and bad things that can happen and expressing love and showing love, it doesn't always play out right, but you will because your heart is centered on Christ. People are not comfortable with vulnerability. If you write this name down, some of you are taking notes and I like it. Write this name down, Brené, B-R-E-N-E. Brown, just like the color. Brené Brown, she has done all this amazing research on vulnerability and shame. So these are touchy-feely things, but she has the research, so it's academic. And she has an amazing thing to share with you. You may have heard her. She's done a few TED Talks, but she is to be explored. She has all kinds of books out about being comfortable with vulnerability. But not everybody feels comfortable showing love because It might show a weakness in you. It might open you as a teacher to be hurt. If I show that I'm loving you and the student doesn't love you back, or I'm investing in you and the student sort of spits on your investment and they do nothing with it, or they come to you all brokenhearted for counseling and you counsel them and you give them sage advice and they take none of it to heart. So it can hurt to care, but we have to care. And here's why people don't feel comfortable. It doesn't seem academic. It seems irrelevant. It may seem indulgent. It makes people feel uncomfortable. It's difficult to measure love, and yet it's almost immediately obvious in the climate of a classroom. You visit a classroom and you'll go, whoa, there is so much love and care in this ensemble, I cannot believe it. Or you'll walk in and go, I'm afraid to breathe. I was in Little Rock, the last time regional convention was in Little Rock, and I went to go watch this famous conductor. And I was in there about 5 minutes and I was afraid to breathe. It was so, he was so harsh. And if I said the name, some of you would know him. It was so harsh and brittle. And I was like, this is wrong. This feels unhealthy. This doesn't feel inclusive. This doesn't feel inspiring. This doesn't feel motivational. This doesn't feel healthy. And I have got to get out of here at the soonest moment I can. And I went across the hall, and wouldn't you know, the very opposite of that, Bob Chilcott was across the hall. It was so awesome. The next thing I know, I'm sitting on the piano bench next to the pianist. I had to get so close to Bob Chilcott, and I was turning her pages and patting her back. I knew her, so it was sort of comfortable, and I was like, oh, I never want to leave this room. And he was loving those singers, and he was showing them how you can, not you're so bad, and you're making the same mistake again, and yada, 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 right? So when you're rehearsing, don't stick with mistakes too long. Stick with what we're going to do. Well, choir, have you thought about this? Well, band, have you thought about this? Do you think we could tongue that a little bit harder at measure 45 instead of, oh my goodness, every time we're at measure 45, you have the sloppy tongue and the articulation's terrible and we've got a concert and this is embarrassing. Skip past all of that and talk about what can be and how we can do it. And your teaching will be beautiful. Ask students about their good teachers and you'll hear things like, hey, Mr. O is really there when he teaches. Mrs. P has such zestful enthusiasm. You can tell this is really Mr. Q's whole life, like he's on a mission, and you are. D, it really bothers Mrs. R when our test grades are low. All of these are real comments that I've had students say in my classroom. And this one about Mr. R, and it wasn't Mr. R, it was Mrs. R, it was Mr. S, who was the math teacher. The students would tell me, Mr. Lolly, when we get a bad grade in math, it really hurts his feelings. He feels like he has let us down and been a terrible teacher. And so we study harder for math because we can't be hurting his feelings. Whoa, that's significant. So it wasn't a bruising of his ego like, you guys are terrible, I taught you all this and you can't even do it. It was like, oh my goodness, I have failed you. I let you down, you got a D. How can I teach this better to you, right? Think about that in applying it to your own teaching. I've never seen Mrs. S in a bad mood ever. Never, she floats. And you know what, when you find, this is a quote, it's not mine, when you find your life's calling, they say that you'll never work a day in your life. Sharon's 50th year, my 30th year, but we don't go to work, right? We go to school and we love school and we love students and we love music, but it isn't work. When you find your life's call, you won't work one day in your life. At the root of all these good teachers is one common denominator. Love. Love of subject, love of sharing, teaching, love of people, love of life. Love is the only way. You can resist love. You can put up a shield of perfection. Brené Brown says that perfectionism is a 200-pound shield. I'm perfect. Why? Because I don't want you to see that I have flaws, right? I'll have the perfect answer. That was fantastic. You are beautiful. Oh, you're just wonderful. I was at a banquet one time, and Jingling Tam, who teaches in Texas, I can't remember where Jingling teaches.
North Texas, maybe so.
She leaned over to me and she said, Mark, you know what is wrong with American culture. I said, no, I don't. But somehow, all of a sudden, I felt responsible for American culture. She said, I will tell you, go into any American child's bedroom and look on their dresser, what do you see? I said, I don't know, because I was really nervous. Like, it's my fault. I'm so sorry, Jingli. Please don't hurt me. She said, I'll tell you what you see. Medals and trophies. And she said, and for what? Mediocrity. They put on a t-shirt, they put on a uniform. You're the best. You get a trophy, you get a medal. You're the best. That's why America's mediocre. You know what? She's right. She's right. With good-hearted intention, we say, excellent, lie. Lying is a sin. You are excellent. How about this? You are trying so hard. You are trying so hard. And here's what you can do better, right? So you're obligated. You're going to find yourself, because you have a heart for teaching or you wouldn't be getting a music ed degree, wanting to encourage students, but you might find yourself lying. I have found myself lying. We cannot be lying. We have to speak the truth in love. There's a reason we have that scripture. So you say, okay, you're coming 15 minutes late. This is very bad for our rehearsal. And it says something about commitment. I can't have you doing that. So if you come late, again, one more time, this is what will happen for you. But you know what? I think if you set an alarm on your phone, right? Or you know what? If you want me to call you, I will call you. Or do I need to call your mama, right? You find a way to make them successful and they will be successful and they'll get, oh, he's not only correcting me because he loves me, but he's showing me a way that I can do better, right? And they will do better. What happens if you resist love? If you keep yourself safe from vulnerability, I love this quote by C.S. Lewis. To love at all is to be vulnerable. And you know what? I hate it. I've been hurt this year. Not devastated, but I have been hurt this year by students. Did they mean to hurt me? No. Why did I get hurt? Because I love them. I want the best for them. I want them to do what I say. Like any conductor, we want people to do what we say. And so we have to be aware of our faults too. But I want students to do what I say. And if they're doing something bad and I say, you need to do this, you need to practice this many hours. I need this from you in rehearsal, and they don't do it, it hurts me. I love you, and I see what you're capable of doing, and when they don't do it, it hurts me. But here's the thing. Love anything, and your heart will certainly be wrung and possibly broken. My heart has not been broken. If you want to make sure of keeping it intact, you must give your heart to no one, not even to an animal. Wrap it carefully around with hobbies and little luxuries. Avoid all entanglements. Don't care. Don't invest. Don't have the conversation. Just get to your office, get to your podium, shut yourself off, teach, and then get away. Lock it up, safe in the casket or coffin of your selfishness. But in that casket, safe, dark, motionless, airless, it will change. It will not be broken. It will become unbreakable, impenetrable, irredeemable. It takes courage to show up every day with a heart full of love, to invest, to cross the commitment line, to give and give and give again. I had a student, same convention in Little Rock. Grant Sloan was singing that he's one of the best basses I ever had. And he needed his solo to be in a really low key. It wasn't available. So I sat in my hotel room at the Peabody and wrote it out by hand. Note by note by note by note. He comes to his solo practice. He does not know the solo. I said, Grant, I sat in my hotel room with a pencil and manuscript writing out this so you can sing it in a key that shows off your voice and you don't know the solo. I'm sorry. I said, I don't need an I'm sorry. I need you to do something about it. I'm investing in you for your good. Now you go home and practice. And I want to hear it tomorrow. So he comes back and he said, Mr. Lawley, part of the story you didn't know is that we don't have, I made him a practice tape. We had tapes. He said, we don't have a tape recorder at my house. I sat in my car last night for 2 hours and practiced in the driveway. I don't know if it was 2 hours. I don't want to go to hell. I sat in my driveway and practiced a solo until I know it, and I can sing it for you today. I said, let's hear it. And he sang it so beautifully, right? Give them away, but also hold them accountable. You know, you're gonna invest in them, and you need to, in a healthy way, get alongside them, require their excellence, and they will give it to you. Mark Gideon said about Sharon Wilkins, when he was a sophomore or junior, he said, Sharon Wilkins said to me, it's time to step it up. She'd been investing in him, she'd been nurturing him, she'd been coaxing him a couple years, and now she said, it's time for you to step it up. This is what I want you to do this year. He says that behind your back. Here's what love is not. Oh, I want to say this too. It takes courage to show up every day with a heart full of love. It's easier to teach and conduct behind a facade. You know, oh, everything's just fine. But the music will not speak, the learning will not deepen, and the climate will suffer. What love is not? Love is not a pink tutu and a diamond tiara. It's not, oh, I love you all, I love you all. It's not fake. It's not being a pushover. It's not spending every day talking about your feelings. It's not lowering your standard. It's not a bunch of mushy slush. It's not accepting second-rate work. It's not about being friends or buddies with your students. It's not about becoming everyone's counselor. Tuesday night, I had a rehearsal with Boys Choir of Springfield, and we could have had a really fun rehearsal. We did not. We could have had a really, we could have laughed our heads off and just had a blast. But we have a concert, and it was time to require them. Boom. And so I was very strict with them, and we had little rehearsal breaks where we were silly and we wiggled things, and, you know, it was appropriate for their age. But I said to them at the, well, during the rehearsal, I made them raise their right hand. This is my left, but it encouraged them to use the right hand. So they raised their right hand, and I said, repeat after me. So you guys, you're the boys, so you repeat after me. Repeat after me. Are you ready? If I'm capable.
I'm
responsible.
I'm responsible.
If I can.
If I can.
I must.
I will.
Don't try to stop me, Mr. Lolly.
Don't try to stop me, Mr.
Lolly. Don't get in my way of excellence.
Don't get in my way of excellence.
Because I'll run right over you.
I'll
sing every note.
I'll
watch you.
I'll
respond.
I'll
get my articulation correct.
God bless America.
So say we all. And then we pound our chest and we put our hand down. Yeah, and I said to them at the end, okay, here's the deal. We could have had a blast tonight. We did not really have a blast, right? We worked hard. We could have had a blast. And you know what would have happened? When you show up on Friday night to sing the concert, it would be a mess. It'd be a mess. Be sloppy. People would come in wrong. People sing out of tune. The balance would be terrible. The soloists wouldn't lead us in the right way. And we would all be embarrassed and humiliated. And we'd think, why did we have a blast on Tuesday so we can be embarrassed and humiliated on Friday? But you know what's going to happen now? Now, we're not going to sing a perfect concert. No way. There will be flaws, okay? But I will love them and I will nurture them and care for them. But you know what will happen? I said to the boys, after the concert Friday, you'll sing the best concert you're capable of singing, and we will have a blast after the concert. We'll look at each other and I'll respect you and you'll respect me, and we'll bring excellence. And then we'll go, woo! That was so fun to bring the best concert we're possible of doing. So you can't always walk around just having fun, right? Your students will want candy from you. They want candy, like, please, let's just give me a sucker. And you'll say, I have vegetables. I have vegetables for you. I will give you something for your musical growth and intelligence. And one day you'll be so happy that you had vegetables when you have all of your teeth, right? You still have your teeth. You're welcome. You're welcome. I could have given you what you wanted. Okay, here's something else to think about love. Like, I don't know you right here. What's your name?
Marcella.
Okay, so I don't know Marcella, but I already love her. She's great for an extrovert. She's responsive, her face responds, her body responds. She's very responsive. I love her, but it's no big deal that I, is it Marcella? Mm-hmm. It's no big deal that I love Marcella already. Why? Because she's easy to love. Oh, should I get a star for loving someone who's lovable? No, there are no stars for me loving Marcella. Let's pretend like you're the meanest person in the world. Now you love this guy who's a hardcore, he hates himself, he has the disease, he said a curse word to you on the first week of school. Now you show up and love this person who has cursed you. That is love. That is love. This is easy. This is a challenge, and that's what you're there. She doesn't even need me to love her. She's so full of life, she's so fulfilled, she has great parents, but here he comes hurting, and because he's hurting, he's striking out at me, but I see, I've done the diagnosis, oh, he has the disease. Oh, okay, I'll have to treat him a different way. Oh, she doesn't have a disease, I'll just get to enjoy her. We'll high five, I love you, and then we'll come to him and I'll go, I believe in you, and yesterday, these five things, and I know you're gonna do it today, I'm gonna be watching you, and I know you're bringing me excellence, and you can do it. Real love loves the difficult, unlovable, abrasive, undeserving. Expecting the very best from your students, expecting them to step up in terms of focus, commitment, and contribution, just like Sharon Wilkins, giving 100% of yourself in preparation, literature selection, being rested, being well, being centered and present. Seek first to inspire is my mantra. I fail at my mantra. Did you know it's okay to fail? and say, my mantra is, I will go into every rehearsal and I'll inspire every singer. And sometimes I find myself demanding from every singer and being authoritative, and I have failed my own mantra, seek first to inspire. Guess what? I can do better. And the next rehearsal, I'll do my very best to seek to inspire. Be sensitive to students who march to the beat of a different drummer, and nearly all of them, and you and me, nearly all of us do, and that's the beauty of working with artists. It's so fascinating. One of my favorite things to do in front of a classroom or an ensemble is just do a quick scan. And I think sometimes, Jesus loves the little children. And I start thinking about how creative God is. Like, I said this to my women's choir last year. Who knew that beautiful could look so many different ways? So I looked at them and I said, now look at each other. You will see how beautiful can look so many different ways. How amazing is God that we have 60 women, we've got 60 versions of beautiful. That is blowing my mind right now. It is so incredible. Okay. Sometimes love is giving them what they need versus what they want. We talked about that already. They want candy, but you want them to have teeth. Building a wall of protection around students. Here's a wonderful real letter. And Sharon's heard me read this letter before. This is to Mr. Grega at Parkview High School from one of his students. I've typed long enough. I've typed enough, so I'll let you go. But before I do, I want to say one more thing. I'm actually at work with tears in my eyes writing this. I know you hear this a lot, and it is well deserved, but you can never know the impact you have made on my life. You planted a seed in me when you auditioned me before my freshman year. You were very firm in saying that you would not put up with me acting foolishly all the time. Then you trusted me enough to allow me to sing a solo at the junior high concert. The little Irish girl, and that carried on through my high school days. Even when I started trying to destroy myself, you still cared. You didn't ignore me. You rallied friends around me and built a barrier that tried to harness me. It would have been easy to let me go, but you didn't. Singers are a dime a dozen, but you still stayed with me when you didn't have to. The feelings that I felt when I was singing in your choir were better than any drug or drink I have ever known. God knows I searched a long time for the peace you were showing me. I still remember the concert at the Methodist Church when we sang, "There is a balm in Gilead." I replay that in my head over and over. My parents lost the tape of that concert, but I still remember it and always will. Mr. Grega, if there ever was a man on this earth with whom I knew what his purpose was, it would be you. God sent you to touch the lives of thousands of kids. I pray that kids you have now enjoy and soak up the enthusiasm that truly oozes from you. Even though I don't see you or hear from you much, I just want you to know that you are one of those influential people that came along at the right time in my life that helped me beyond any realm of thought you will ever know. I can't speak for anyone else, but for me, you are my gift from God himself. Thank you. Grega loved his student just the way he was. Spoke the truth in love. I'm not gonna have you acting foolishly. I'm gonna give you the solo. I'm gonna invest in you. I'm gonna rally your friends around you because we're not gonna let you drown. We're not gonna let you suffer. We're gonna let you go. And he created the wall of protection around him. Two final thoughts and then a song, and we're probably close to time. We're close to time, right? There is no neutral. So you might think on days that you've been wounded a little bit and you show up to teach student teaching or when you actually become a teacher, you think, you know what? I'm just gonna go in neutral today. My heart's hurting a little bit. I'm a little raw. Can't go there. There is no neutral. There is no, that doesn't exist. You're either moving forward, you're either influencing for the good, or you're moving backwards. Or you're being selfish with the gifts God has given you, and he placed you in that school. That is your mission field. And there is no neutral, so you have to be moving forward. The next thought, and this is very short, we are powerful. We are powerful. Never underestimate the power of presence. You are a power of presence in that classroom. And either you're shining and inspiring and energizing and caring and passionately giving, or the opposite of that. You are powerful, and words are powerful. What you say, I want you to be thinking almost to the point of driving yourself crazy about how you say what you say. I took my choir 2005 to San Francisco, and the tour company said these words to us. Now, we're not gonna have any problem. We never have problems on our trips, never have problems. We have opportunities and solutions. So if there are some opportunities, we would appreciate you sharing the opportunities with us, and we'll give you a solution. That would be a brilliant way to go into the classroom. Opportunities and solutions. Someone's mad at you, a student, a parent, opportunity, opportunity, and now you have a solution. You're gonna write a little prescription. Oh, well, here's what we're gonna do about this opportunity. Thank you for bringing that to my attention. When you might be hurt, you might start feeling defensive. Don't go down that path. It's crazy. Don't go down that path. Just go, this is an opportunity for me to solve something. I'm a professional teacher. I'm a practicing teacher. I will write a diagnosis. He's got the disease. And now I'm going to write a prescription and a plan of action, and we'll have a solution. Yeah. Teaching is the finest work I know. And I have had the finest teachers. If I was not an effective teacher, I would be a miserable failure. Why? Because God put in my path amazing people who invested in me, right? And my job is to bring honor to the calling that God has given me and to bring honor to my teachers who have invested in me. And you know, when you think about yourself, you think, I can't, I'm not smart enough, I'm not talented enough, I'm not articulate, I don't sing well, I don't play the piano well. And when you start thinking about yourself, it's like, oh. When you think, Sharon Wilkins invested in me. Can I take the podium for Sharon Wilkins? Yes. My parents got me lessons. Can I take the podium for my parents? Yes. God put me here. Can I take the podium for God? Oh, yes, I can. And then when you start thinking about every person who invested something good in you and your teachers, you can take the classroom. You can take the podium to bring honor to them and to him. And the more you can get yourself out of the equation, the healthier and more effective you will be. I want to challenge you with this closing song by Sarah Groves, who's an Evangel alum, a concert choir alum, about loving a person. This is the calling in teaching. The calling is to love and to love a person just the way they are. Do you guys already know this song? Okay, one more thought and then we'll listen to the song. And the words are in here, pardon?
What's the name of it?
I'm loving a person. Yeah. So here's the deal. On Wednesdays, when I was teaching public school, it was Sarah Groves Song Day. I didn't call it that. But I would hand them the lyrics to a Sarah Groves song, and there would be some, sometimes spiritual, and sometimes just life lesson. And we would listen to the song. Sometimes I would give a little devotional, which was not devotional, but just a speech, or I might not say anything. And this is the one. There will be challenging people in your classroom who are hurting, right? And you can love them, and that's what they need. That's what we all need. It's the common denominator. We all need love. And you can love them. And when you love Marcella, big deal. But when you love this guy, that is where the real work is, just the way they are. So I want you to listen to this real quick.
Just the way they are, it's no small thing. It takes some time to see things through. Sometimes things change, sometimes we're waiting. We need grace either way. Hold on. I person just the way they are. That's no small thing. That's the whole thing. Loving me just the way I am. It's no small thing. Take some time. Take some time. Take some time. Take some time.
Let's end with prayer. How about that? God, you are so good. You are so good. We want to be like you. We want to be loving students and encouraging them and requiring their best, helping them to see talents they don't even know they have. Help us, Lord, to see things through, to not let an offense create a wall between us and anyone, but help us, Lord, seek restoration and healing. And I pray, Lord, for us as teachers and future teachers, you will stir our hearts and do a work in us so that others will know you, to know the beauty, the healing that comes from a life spent with you, the purity. God, be in each one of these evangel students as they prepare to take the classroom, to invest in students, to love them, to encourage them, to help them grow deep roots of wholeness. God, prepare the path for them. Keep their hearts stirred. Keep, God, their minds open to placement where you will put them on their own mission field, their own podium, their own classroom, their own lectern. God, be in them, all of you, in all of them. In Jesus' name, amen.